protests in New Haven, Connecticut, over 300 people gathered and marched. Nearly three dozen students from my campus, Connecticut College, woke up early that Saturday morning and drove to New Haven to join this nationwide effort. They brought handmade signs, and one of them took over the microphone and inspired the crowd with a brief speech before leading the chant, "Yes to Love." Their passion, anger, and conviction was contagious. I began with this story because it was a turning point for me as a lesbian historian and activist who has remained ambivalent about the gay marriage movement, particularly as it has overshadowed other LGBTQ civil rights issues. As historians, we have several important contributions to make to contemporary conversations, not only on gay marriage, but on LGBTQ civil rights more generally. It is an understatement to say that many LGBTQ historians and queer studies scholars have been surprised as we have watched gay marriage become elevated as the singular and most significant gay rights issue of our times. Some gay activists are disappointed or in disagreement with this agenda. Others are outright opposed. While a major theme of this mini-conference has been to highlight the history of marriage as an institution to provide historical perspective on the current national debate about which forms of relationships are worthy of particular social, legal, and recognitions, that is only one piece of the puzzle. The real context, which is absent from most conversations over gay marriage, is its relationship to the history of the gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender, civil rights movement. And this is where it gets tricky. The historical profession was explicitly hostile to serious analysis of lesbian and gay history for so long that many of the earliest works of gay history were published by non-academic historians or scholars trained in other fields. Jonathan Ned Katz, a non-academic, wrote Gay American History, Lesbians and Gay Men in the U.S. Literary critic Lillian Fadiman wrote Odd Girls and Twilight Lovers, The History of Lesbian Life in 20th Century America. Boots of Leather, Slippers of Gold, The History of a Lesbian Community, a seminal classic by librarian Madeline Davis and anthropologist Elizabeth Kennedy, are a few examples, as well as Esther Newton's Cherry Grove, Fire Island, and Esther's Anthropologist. The gay and lesbian community has created many of our own archives, recognizing that if we did not preserve the documents, lives, and histories of ourselves and each other, that no one would. The major collections can be found in San Francisco, Chicago, and New York. But dozens of other cities, including San Diego, have rich and diverse holdings as well. Of course, things have changed over the past 30 years. The explosion of original monographs in LGBTQ history over the past 15 years, the increasing acceptance of LGBT studies as an important and legitimate field of scholarly engagement, and widespread student interest in sexuality studies are all evidence of this shift. Some of these important works include John D'Amelio's Sexual Politics, Sexual Communities, The Making of a Homosexual Minority in the United States, 1940 to 1970. Mark Stein's City of Sisterly and Brotherly Loves, Lesbian and Gay Philadelphia, 1945 to 1972. John Howard's Men Like That, Carica Bullock's Book on Provincetown, Marcella Gallo's Different Daughters, The History of the Daughters of Politis, and the Rise of the Lesbian Rights Movement, David Johnson's Lavender Scare, Ned Boyd's Wide Open Town, Dan Horowitz's Bohemian LA, and this year Jennifer Breyer's new book, Infectious Ideas, Todd White's Pre-Gay LA, and several others. Too many for me to name. This surge in publications has resulted in the creation of a usable past, a body of work in LGBT movement history, which is not, as some people say, a narrow subspecialty within 20th century US political history. Rather, histories of the LGBTQ movement and our communities more generally provide exactly the kind of depth and breadth of information one needs to develop a nuanced understanding of one of the most hotly debated social and legal issues of our day, the role and status of LGBTQ people in American society. Historian Carica Bullock recently remarked, "It is unheard of for an issue to be so central to American political life and debate, and yet for there to remain so little knowledge of or interest in our past." Some of you are aware that this year's AHA is becoming a part of the story of the LGBTQ civil rights movement right now, as we speak. We are meeting in the Manchester Grand Hyatt Hotel, which is currently being boycotted by the LGBT and labor communities in San Diego for its owner's role in financing the movement for Prop 8. This alliance includes the San Diego LGBT Center, San Diego Equality Campaign, Californians Against Hate, San Diego Alliance for Marriage Equality, Marriage Equality USA San Diego, Sleep with the Right People, Southern California, Equality California, the Courage Campaign, Unite Your International Union, and the San Diego County Labor Council. These groups are committed to enforcing the boycott and will not enter this hotel. They expect that Manchester will use the AHA's decision to hold the mini-conference on same-sex marriage, of which this panel is a part, as evidence that LGBT groups are no longer boycotting this hotel. LGBTQ historians have been having some difficult conversations amongst ourselves over the past few weeks. Some have decided not to participate this year at all. Others are attending the conference, but standing with the boycott will not enter the Hyatt under any circumstances. Local activists and LGBTQ historians from all over the country are not here today in this session to participate in this conversation because they chose to stand with integrity and conviction for the principle of LGBTQ justice and equality. So where does that leave the rest of us?